Do you want to feel like your favorite fantasy heroes? Do you want to be like the cool kids that were able to shoot a bow and were at home grinding cod? Do you think that today's society is divided by a constant increase in wealth inequality that will eventually lead to the collapse of the modern world as we know it? Then you are in the right video, because I'll try to beat Dark Souls 3 with only archery, meaning only bows and no crossbows, no spells, no regular weapons, and, as always, all bosses, no major glitches, no summons with the DLCs. Only one class starts with a bow, so we don't have much choice. We fight Gundyr, and we only have 30 arrows total without a way to buy them yet, so we can only do so much damage, and if we die we have to reset, but they are more than enough arrows and it's Gundyr, come on. Now we can buy the arrows from the maiden, so not having enough damage won't be a problem anymore. In the high wall we can find a longbow, it's a small damage up, and we have to take the sale key in order to save Greyrat. He'll sell us almost all the good arrows later on. We proceed against Vort. For once in these challenges this fight isn't hard, we just have to keep our distance and know the range and timings of his attacks. Phase 2 can look scary with all the charges, but we just have to forget about trying to hit him and dodge them. Worst case scenario, we'll attack only during the frost breath attacks. Eventually, Vort falls. In the Undead Settlement we can take Loretta's Bone, and why not, let's save the 5 free levels NPC. We ignore both the giant arrows and the boss for now, but we make a stop to kill a demon with our friend Sigvard. It's 3 souls. Literally, they are risk free, because ranged weapons in this game sometimes break enemies' AI. We can take Flynn's Ring, it will give us a bit more damage if we have a low equip load, and we can say hi to the giant. Who could ever hurt this guy for personal gain? Such a chill dude. We run through the Road of Sacrifices, since there isn't anything really important here, and after making the 2 guardians fall we reach Farron Keep. We can take 2 bows here. The Dream Chaser's Ashes allow us to buy the composite bow that we will use for most of the run, and if we kill this guy in the back we can take the Black Bow of Faris, that has a cool attack that shoots 3 arrows at the same time. Too bad it's pretty much useless because it's too slow, but it's cool enough to be mentioned. I get my 3 levels, and I don't know if you can relate to it, but I know at least a couple of people that look like this. Maybe here in Italy the weather hits differently though. It's time to fight the Crystal Sage, and as always in this run, he's the fan police. The first phase is really easy, when we hit him with a normal attack he's staggered, so it's not a problem at all. The second phase, though, is tough. Our attacks are too slow to attack him out in the open, we simply end up penetrated by 5 soul spears at the same time, so we can either kill the clones, one by one, slowly, and pray that the sage doesn't teleport away after getting hit once, or we can hide behind a pillar, kill the ones that can hit us, and attack behind cover. Also, I ended up not using Finn's ring to get some defense, and it will happen multiple times in this run. The sage wasn't knowledgeable enough to avoid getting pierced 80 times, and we proceed. We go into the Cathedral of the Deep, but after realizing that our damage is so low that we have no chance of beating the deacons, I bailed out and went to fight the Abyss Watchers. This fight is pretty easy, but only if you are willing to lose your honor. I gave mine away a couple of runs ago. We have to always be at a distance. They will try to hit us with charge attacks and close the gap, but there are many windows where we can deal damage. And if they get hit by an arrow and they aren't attacking, they flinch, and this should be enough to beat phase 1. Now we have to be a bit more defensive. He has many follow-up attacks and the flames on the sword give him additional range, and we risk getting one shot killed, so, in doubt, always dodge. If we attack after a roll, we deal an attack that deals less damage and usually doesn't stagger enemies, but is a lot faster, and here it can be really useful. It may be a cowardly way to fight, but it works, and we can proceed in the catacombs. Here we don't need anything as usual, so we go deeper, until we encounter the bridge. We can't cut it down with regular arrow attacks, and some of you may think that we need the bow from the DLC to do this, but it's not actually true. We can use the weapon art of a longbow and it works, easy as that, but I went and took the DLC bow anyway. I'm sorry, Infa. We go down, and after some flaming 3 souls, we can get some crafting material, and since we are already here, why not fight the old Demon King? This boss is pretty tanky, but his moves are slow, so there is nothing to worry about. We will be far away from him for all the fight. After a distance, the arrows will start to lose damage, and this bow doesn't have a lot of range, but that distance is pretty far, so don't worry for now. Don't forget that he blows up at the end, and we go out of there without even being hit. Waldir is up next, and I think arrows can destroy his bracelets, but I'm not sure. Hitting them is really annoying, but when I see one of them explode, I'm relieved knowing that it can be done, and shortly after, the fight ends. I tried to delay this fight as much as possible, but now we have to fight the deacons of the deep. Having a ranged weapon here is really annoying, because all the deacons will be a human shield protecting who we have to hit, and our time is limited since they will eventually start channeling the curse spell. I use the weapon art that allows us to rapid fire arrows, even though they will deal less damage, but there isn't a cool strategy that we can apply. We have to stay at melee range and get lucky. After some trials, I managed to defeat them. We can save Zygvard, and Irithyll is ours to conquer. We run around the city, meeting Zygvard again, and after realizing that we aren't the best archer here, we send Greyrath to pillage the place. A few shortcuts later, and we can fight the boss of this area, Pontiff Sullivan. He is really aggressive, has good range, and can easily close the gap between us, making it a tough fight. Our damage, though, is way higher than I expected. The key here is that he, as most bosses do, will not attack us relentlessly, but will walk around or do little dodges in between being aggressive. Sometimes they will even walk towards you doing nothing, and as long as you walk back and keep the same distance, you can get a lot of damage in. Phase 2 can look scary, but it's not that hard. The Pontiff does the same attacks as the clone, but with a delay. So, usually after dodging the first one, if we have proper spacing, we can stand still and deal damage. With one last trade, the Pontiff falls. We need all the power we can get now. So, first of all, we can buy better arrows from Greyrath, with the large ones being the best of the bunch. And then we trigger the fight against the Dancer of the Boreal Valley. I struggled in this fight until I decided that Flynn's ring wasn't worth it, and with armor on, I am still fragile, but I won't get one-shot killed. The Dancer has far more range and faster attacks than I remembered, so I had to play very defensively. It may not look like it, but after you fire with the bow you have a pretty long time to wait before you can roll again, so we get punished a lot. I use the environment to my advantage. The room is small compared to her swords, but if you manage to let her get stuck behind a pillar or in general attack near them, she will be unable to move forward while attacking, reducing her range significantly. All that said, we are doing this fight before we are supposed to, in order to make our life easier later, so it makes sense that it's tougher than the previous ones. With the death of the Dancer, we can loot Lothric Castle, allowing us to power up our bow since it's filled with titanite chunks, and from there I started to tie up loose ends. First in line is Aldrich, where we have an archery standoff. Since they take additional damage if hit in the human part, and we hit them there by default, our damage is pretty good. We aren't so squishy to get one shot killed, so the fight is mostly running around waiting for an opening, and it can look hard, because of all the little purple spheres that they conjure, but we just need to dodge the numerous swipes. Or we can tank the hit, but I wouldn't call it the most efficient strategy. It's up to you to decide. The guy has like 5 total attacks, so we easily prevail as the strongest archer. We then venture into Irithyll Dungeon, where we dodge some jailers. And from there, we reach the Profane Capital. Here we can find Zygvard. We save him to get a titan in his lab, but unfortunately he won't be able to help us against Yorm. So sorry to hear that. And regarding Yorm, there is another problem. You see, he is giant, meaning he's very tall, and our bow doesn't reach very far. There is a ring that increases the reach, but I'm not very proud of how it got into my hands. This fight is a gimmick, meaning you're supposed to use a sword you find in the arena to fight him, but I like to flex on the game. After we deal around 2000 damage to his head, he will be staggered and take additional damage until he gets back up. So it may look like a really long fight at first, but it's not that bad. His attacks are pretty slow, so what we have to do is walk away from him while shooting arrows, and when we get to the end of the room, roll between his legs and repeat. In the second phase, he has an attack with his right punch that comes out pretty fast, but it's a pretty straightforward fight. I brought with me dark arrows. He is actually weak to dark, but that's not the main reason. These arrows will slightly chase their target, and since we deal a lot more damage when we hit him in the head, opposed to hitting anywhere near the head, they are really worth it. They almost never miss the target in this fight. We actually would deal more damage with the regular arrows. It's because of split damage. I won't go too much into the details here, but basically normal arrows add to the physical damage our bow does. Dark arrows will do some dark damage and some physical damage, and in this game a single big number surpasses resistances better than 2 small ones. And hey, consider subscribing if you liked that I did even the gimmick boss with a bow. It helps out a lot. We win and we are teleported to the Dancer, but she's already dead. After a quick trip in the garden, we can fight Oceiros. The first phase of this fight is pretty easy. Slow attacks, and we can deal basically 3 damage since we are ranged. The second phase though was a lot harder. He keeps on running around, dealing a ton of damage, and because of how targeting works in this game, if he keeps going in a direction that isn't directly towards us or away from us, our arrows will miss every time. His waiting time between attacks is very short, and usually his main weakness is that he won't be able to hit you if you are between his hind legs, but our attacks are so slow that he can turn around and punish us. That said, with enough attempts, we managed to eventually take him down, mainly by being patient. We then proceed into the Untended Graves, where we can fight Champion Gundyr. This fight is easier than the previous one, and not that much harder than the original Gundyr. In the first phase we can hit him almost freely, and our damage is pretty good. The second one is harder, and I guess I'm seeing a pattern here, since it's like the 56th boss in a row that has a second phase that is harder and more aggressive, and he won't be the last. If we headshot him, he will be staggered and take additional damage, but I don't think it's worth going for them. We will get some incidental ones due to the 8 defense in the arena though. We have to roll a lot, but eventually one last arrow pierces him and we win. We cleared the path previously, so reaching the Dragon Slayer armor is not a problem. Our damage is decent, and this fight is about knowing its attacks more than the previous ones. It will often stay with the shield up, nullifying our damage, so we need to know if we can get an arrow in before an attack will reach us, if we can simply walk back a bit and hit because the attack will miss us, or if we have to be patient and dodge. Here we also start to use the roll attack more, that will shortly become a staple of this run. But let's not get ahead of ourselves, because in the meantime I had to clutch the last quarter of HP to win. First try, baby! We venture into the archives, where we ignore the crystal sage and gather some twinkling titanite. Shortly after we climb some stairs and we begin one of the hardest fights in these runs, the twin princes. Lorian hits hard and hits fast, so we have to use the roll attack a lot. Sometimes he will attack when he can't even hit us, and we have to recognize that moment and deal damage, because there really are a few openings in this fight. The most important thing though is that sometimes he will crawl towards us, not doing anything, similar to what the pontiff did. But in this case the arena is so big that if we manage to remain at the right distance, not too far and not too close, we can walk away from him and deal almost half of his health without any risk. After that, a couple of rolls, a bit of luck with his AI, and we can begin phase 2. As always, if we end the first phase where they can see us, we can freely heal and damage them once. Now we almost only deal damage with the roll attacks. They are too aggressive and our normal attacks are too slow to hit. Ideally, we would want to hit Lothric, because when he dies the fight ends, but it's not easy to do. We can only target the Elder Brother, and we aim fairly low, so that we can only hit the one in the back if we roll directly behind them, or if we stand in a very precise spot to their left. What is sure is that the correct technique is to fight them at melee range. It is, as always been in these runs, that forced me to use ranged attacks. We end up hitting Lorian most of the time, so that he dies and gets revived not once, not twice, but 3 times in this whole phase of the fight. We have to clutch it out a bit at the end, and 99 arrows later we managed to kill them. It's almost time for the really hard fight, but first we have to prune the cursed rotted greatwood. It's an early game boss, so it's really easy, but it's the only one where we have to heavily rely on aim, so I guess it's a bit interesting. And now it's time for all the optional and hard content. We run around in Ariandel. We can cut this bridge too with just a longbow, and since the Grave Tender is probably the most frustrating boss in the whole run, we'll deal with him later. In the meantime, we have to defeat Sir Vilheim. He's a tough opponent, mainly because he can heal and we can't interrupt him, but he still hits hard, and, as any NPC in this game, when we shoot an arrow we can decide to roll and always avoid them, meaning that we will usually only hit him when he's in the middle of an attack animation. I don't know if he can only heal a set amount of times, or I just got lucky with this AI, but after a bit we win, and after proceeding in some snowy hills and some waste, we can fight Sister Frida. The first phase is easy, our damage is good, she can dodge our arrows easily, but she will never dodge if she is in the stance with the sight on her shoulders, and if we hit her, we will stagger her. Moreover, when she turns invisible, we can stun lock her by hitting her in the head repeatedly. It won't work later, but for now, it's a free win. The second phase begins, and here we want to target mostly Ariandel. He is so big big that we won't miss most of the time, and it takes more damage. We still need to keep an eye on Frida. Her ranged attacks are pretty sludge, but she can turn invisible and cast a healing spell. It will take quite some time to do it though, and we can stagger her with an arrow, but if it resolves it will heal for a lot. All we need to do after that is keep our distance and shoot arrows with regular attacks, since they deal more damage, and we can begin phase 3. Here I embered and I switched to dark arrows, not because they deal more damage, but, as with Yorm, because they are homing, and Frida has a small hitbox, dodges a lot, and our target is fairly high, near her neck, meaning that sometimes we can miss an arrow if she stands still but moves slightly down preparing an attack. When she turns invisible we can easily track her down thanks to the non-invisible arrows in her chest, and as I said, now the stun lock doesn't work, but a headshot is still extra damage. We have to dance with her in this fight. She will attack relentlessly with very long sequences, and even when she does lower ice attacks they will explode after a short amount of time, forcing us to dodge at least a couple of times every time she attacks. We use a lot of rolling attacks here, and what usually happens is that we dodge her attack, throw an arrow, and she dodges the arrow, ready to attack again. We have to take some risk in the fight in order to win in a reasonable amount of time, but in theory we could dodge everything and only attack when she turns invisible. After a long time and a pretty cool fight, one last arrow connects and we can point her down. We jump into the drag heap, and after running around in the ash and the state mandated Dark Souls poisonous swamp, we can fight the demons. This fight can be hard. They deal a good amount of damage, yes, but they are pretty slow and have like 7 moves total, including phase 2. The real problem is that they have a ton of HP and the fight takes a really long time, even if you are constantly hitting them, so you are prone to lose focus and make mistakes. That said, phase 1 is pretty easy. There's 2 of them, but the ranged one is almost useless. His attacks are really easy to tell, are slow, and there's a long time between them, so we can ignore him. We will focus our attention on the melee one. He basically has 2 attacks and they are very similar, so simply walk away from him the whole time, throwing arrows when you're safe. You need to feel where you are in the arena, because it's really big, but if you find yourself unexpectedly with your back to the wall, you can be in trouble. Sometimes they will be a bit desynchronized, meaning there will be 2 melee or 2 ranged ones at the same time, and in the latter case we can deal a ton of free damage. I think that killing the demon in pain first is the way to go, but at this point I don't even try the fight against the version with the demon from below first. In the second phase we really don't have good damage. Thankfully we are at a high enough level where only the laser can kill us in one hit. The strategy here is to only try to deal damage after he attacks, while almost always walking away from him. Spatial awareness is less important here, since we have to run away a lot only if he charges at us, and it's not super common. You need to recognize the laser attack when it begins, because if you dodge the wind that tries to knock you down, you can get near him just by running, and that's some more free damage. The fight isn't particularly hard, but as I said before, you need to be focused for a long time, and after 124 arrows we win, and we can fly to the ringed city. Here we need to do the standard stuff. Dodging arrows, curses, daggers, huge swords, insects, and even a huge dragon. Thankfully, we only need to run to do it, so not a big deal. We have to fight Midir for the first time, and at first I tried to hit him from the entrance of the cave. He can't hit us here, but he did almost no damage, but it's for sure a viable strategy with a bow with more range. What I ended up doing instead is a bit cheap, but my opponent has no honor either, so it didn't bother me that much. There are a couple of rocks in front of him, and they are there to protect you from his fire breath, but after he fires at you and misses, he will use his next attack on your hiding spot behind the rocks. When he is trying to attack the rocks, you can walk in the middle of the path that leads to him and attack him, meaning that after he finishes attacking he will target you there, and you can easily move behind the rocks, rinse and repeat for 2 minutes and you will fall down. Easy as that. Now we have to fight Half-Light, and it's incredibly frustrating. All the enemies in this fight are able to dodge our arrows whenever they want, because as soon as we attack they will roll. The painting guardians can heal the boss and themselves, and it's common knowledge that they won't heal if they aren't hurt, but here if I killed the first one and didn't even touch the second one, he would heal regardless, so I don't know if it's wrong and it's simply less likely, or if just one of them is hurt they'll both be able to heal. Fighting 3v1 isn't a good idea, so what we have to do is enemies kill the first one before Alphlight spawns. Then fight Alphlight until he loses around a third of HP. Then the second one spawns and we will only focus the Guardian. When he dies, finally, we can properly fight Alphlight. Since he can dodge all our attacks, the only thing we can do is to attack and stagger him after he starts attacking. That way, he won't be able to dodge. This means that a lot of times we'll end up trading hits. We only take a lot of damage if his sword hits us. But I can assure you that an enemy that can decide to not attack for a minute and dodge all of your attacks while you are there wasting time is really, really not fun to play against. That's why I was very happy when he died. And yeah, we died too, but we hit him first, so we don't have to fight him again. We traveled to Archdragon Peak next, and I wasn't sure on how to win the fight, because yes, we can poison it with poison arrows, but it takes a long time and it's really, really boring. Obviously, we can do a plunging attack, but I decided to run all the way around like you're intended to, and I got on top of its head. Turns out that when you get there, it simply puts the head down waiting for you to jump, and we'll simply stay in that position. I can't quite hit it with arrows from there, but there is a ledge near where we can have a clear shot, no reaction from the wyvern. We just have to attack it, and I tried to use a great bow, we'll need it later, but it's not worth it. Also, this is not a glitch, it's the intended behavior programmed into the wyvern. Was it intended that you sat there with a bow for 5 minutes? I don't think so, but you usually kill it in one shot from there, so it's not a real worry. Now we can finally fight one of the hardest bosses in the game, the Nameless King. Well, first we have to kill his dragon, but it takes a lot of damage on the head and we basically only hit the head. Also gets staggered halfway through, and even though we can do a riposte, it dies almost immediately. You may think that we will almost only roll attack against the king, but his attack sequences are so fast that he can hit us anyway. So we have to be patient, roll away, and hit him when he decides to stand still. Sometimes we will get punished anyway, because he is that fast, and sometimes we will think that he has less range than what he actually has, but there isn't much more we can do. As with some previous bosses, sometimes he will decide to walk towards us, and we need to capture these moments because it's when we will deal him most of the damage. I know it doesn't look that cool, but we have to fight with what we have. Here, too, I have both the large arrows and the dark arrows, if I think my next shot is going to miss, but we will mostly attack him when he's still, so the large arrows are the way to go. And after a long fight, we dodge one last attack, and the king falls. We are almost at the end of our journey, only the hardest of the hardest remain. The time has come for the champion Grave Tender, and he has all the annoying feature Alphlight had, meaning he will dodge our attacks every time and we are outnumbered, but he has a unique frustrating ability. He can do a jumping attack against us while keeping his shield up, meaning we can stagger him and we deal basically no damage. It's very hard to hit him. His shield is up almost all the time, and he dodges, so we have to attack and hope that he decides not to block it. I don't know why, but it happens. When he gets to about half HP, he summons his wolf and he takes out a staff. We want to only focus the wolf, because if we get hit by it, we take a ton of damage. The wolf will jump around constantly, and even has a second phase where it attacks faster, because why wouldn't it? But our damage is pretty good. After we manage to take down the wolf, only the Grave Tender remains. And if he has his staff out, we can hit him more reliably, but it's not guaranteed. I started using running attacks, they are as fast as rolling ones, but we have to manually aim them towards him a bit, and they worked quite well to poke him to death. It wasn't particularly fun, but he's dead, and that's all I care about. Slave Knight Gale is our next objective, and it's a tough one. In the first phase, we only have two reliable openings. When he charges at us, we can dodge and hit him with a rolling attack, and whenever he slams his sword into the ground, we can hit him with a regular arrow. Thankfully, most of his attacks are either charges or end with a sword slam, so it still takes a while, but it's not that long, and it's pretty easy. I brought with me poison arrows for this fight. You can only buy them from patches, so you either buy a ton of them from him the first time you meet him, or you can take the tower key and meet him there. Gale is weak to poison, but if you poison him between phase 1 and phase 2, he will heal when entering phase 2, so we will poison him later. The first phase ends and we can pop an ember, and now we will only attack with poison arrows until he is poisoned. It's hard to miss when that happens because you can see the numbers adding up in his HP bar. Now we mostly do roll attacks. Every time he attacks us with the sword, we dodge away from him and we can instantly roll attack. We will almost never get punished. If we see that he's standing around too much, we can do a regular attack or a running attack. If he uses his crossbow, we can run to the side and that's it. When he does more committing attacks, like big jumps, we can dodge and then use the weapon art that does less damage, but I believe has the same poison build up. Not sure though. I poisoned him as he was about to begin phase 3, and now it's actually quite harder. First of level, using poison arrows makes no sense, so we can switch to regular ones. And if before we could hit him after every dodge, now he will do sequences of 1 to 4 attacks, and you can either always assume he's doing 3 or 4 and play super defensively, or you can dodge away a couple of times and hit him if you know that you're out of range. Obviously, to do that, you need to know well his moveset and his range. It's not very hard to do, but it's not easy either. The most important thing, though, is to always be walking away from him. Every time, if you aren't dodging or shooting, we need to be moving away from him. That way, he will attack not directly on top of us, but where we were a second ago, meaning that we can usually dodge twice and hit him while out of range. The poison lasted me to almost the end of the fight, and from there I only needed a couple of good rolls to bring home the victory. It took 114 arrows, but in the end, Gale died and we won. Now it's time to defeat Midir, and it's not going to be pleasant. First of all, I got back into the Ariandel DLC to get the Captain's Ashes. They are on top of the tower with archers, and they allow us to buy unlimited Millwood Great Arrows. They are marginally better than regular Great Arrows, but we need all the help we can get. We hop into the arena. We are going to use the Millwood Great Bow for this fight. If you are doing this challenge yourself and you don't have the Ariandel DLC, don't worry. I'm pretty sure any Great Bow will work, but this has a lot of flavor added to it. Because the description of the Millwood Bow and Arrow says that the Millwood Knights used it to fight their sword enemy, the Abyss Dragon, that I'm guessing is Midir, even though I'm not 100% sure. I think a Great Bow is better in this fight than a regular bow, because Midir has attacks that force you to move or to dodge many times in a row. But they usually end pretty slowly, sometimes even with him putting his head down, meaning that we can easily get in with one great arrow. But we couldn't use 2 or 3 regular arrows in the same amount of time, and roll attacks aren't really worth it, since they deal such a low amount of damage and we won't have enough time to use them in most cases. As you can see, our damage is great, and what I explained previously about split damage is true here, meaning that using lightning arrows actually lowers the damage we deal, even if he's weak to lightning. We want to aim at his head, where he will take a lot more damage, and sometimes we have to aim at it manually because the target isn't reliable when he's moving, but it's not a big deal. The fight doesn't have that many more things to it. We need to know his attacks, dodge them entirely, and then we can usually hit him with one arrow. We get embered to have more HP and get one free heal, but be careful because the dark laser attack will kill us in one hit if the laser part of the attack connects. After avoiding his charge attack, we ready one last Millwood arrow, and our Keter Midir dies. Finally, the Soul of Cinder is a cool final boss, but isn't a hard final boss. We return to our faster setup with the composite bow, because we'll need roll attacks in this fight. And with that, I'll say that you can beat Dark Souls 3 with only archery. If you did this challenge yourself, let me know it in the comments, and if you enjoyed the video, leave a like or even subscribe. I'll see you next time. Well, you'll see me. See the video at least. Why do I always mess up the outro?